let's just kick off with a word of prayer. Father God, we just thank you for who you are. Lord, we thank you that no matter what season we walk through in life, you're always walking with us. And we look to you now, Heavenly Father. We just look to you for the peace that passes all understanding. We thank you, Lord, for Shabbat, Lord. We just thank you that you have commanded us to honor this, Lord. We just put all of our rest and cares in you. And Lord, we just give you tonight, and we love you. In your name we pray, Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus our Messiah. Amen. Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom.
So, if this is your first time here, thank you for coming. Light of Israel. Just really quick, my wife Julie and I, we serve as volunteers with Chosen People Ministries. Chosen People Ministries, as you see, has been in existence for 127 years, was actually founded by an Orthodox rabbi from Hungary 127 years ago. And Chosen People Ministries has missionaries around the world with the sole purpose of bringing the good news of Yeshua Jesus to the Jewish people. If you'd like to know more about Chosen People Ministries, I'd love to talk to you. If you feel like giving towards Light of Israel, we do have a box at the table. Not necessary, but if that's something God puts on your heart, that would be great. So just wanted to let you know about Chosen People Ministries. And with that, we're going to move forward and usher in Shabbat. So when we start Shabbat, it's customary tradition for the woman of the house to light the Shabbat candles. And everything we do, we try to look to the words of Jesus, our Messiah. And in John 8:12, you see the words, "And Jesus again spoke to them, saying, I am the light of the world. He who follows me will not walk in the darkness, but will have the light of life."
Blessed art thou, Lord our God, King of the universe, who has sanctified us by faith in Jesus, our Messiah, the Light of the world. Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom. If you would all please stand, it's also customary to recite the Shema, which is Deuteronomy 6:4. And we'll see that on the screen here in a second. And we also have a verse from John 10 that we'll also go into. Say, we'll say Deuteronomy 6:4 in Hebrew, then English, and then the verse from John in Hebrew and English. So if you know it, please recite it along with me. Shema Israel, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And we'll say this in the same manner as Deuteronomy. Vayomer Yeshua, Ani V'Avi, Ekanaknu. And Yeshua said, I and the Father are one. Please be seated. Well, we're really, really fortunate and blessed to have the dynamic duo of Jeremy and Daniel.
You know this song is called Still God, Still Good. You're welcome to stand if you like.
Say thanks for
Oh,
To this devotional, it's the Word, the One, and our witness, the importance of the Hebrew Scriptures, aka the Old Testament. I know I'm in the right audience when I say the Old Testament's really important, right? Everyone's
got to
shake their heads and say amen. That's not, unfortunately, these days a universal agreement. So we're going to have the main text, if you would, is going to be Luke 24, which is the road to Emmaus, and then also when Jesus presents himself to his disciples. So we're going to have some of the text on the screen, but before we get into the main text, first question I have for everyone is the Word of God. Why is it important? Well, you don't have to turn, but I have a couple selected verses in Psalm 119. Everyone knows Psalm 119, 11. Your word I've treasured in my heart, that I may not sin against you. Verse 41, may your loving kindness Also come to me, O Lord, your salvation according to your word. And maybe one of the most beautiful verses of all the psalm is, your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. So the psalmist here in Psalm 119 is telling us that God's word, his precepts, his law, his teaching is our instruction, is our guide. So the word is important. So we are on the road of righteousness, that we will not get lost and we will not stumble. Well, if you go to the New Covenant and James chapter 1, James says something very important about the word. And this is found in verses 22 to 25. And James says this, "But prove yourselves doers of the word, not merely hearers who delude themselves. For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man who looks at his natural face in a mirror. For once he has looked at himself and gone away, he has immediately forgotten what kind of person he was. But one who looks intently," I think that's a key word in this verse, "looks intently at the perfect law, the law of liberty, and abides by it," another key word, "not having become a forgetful hearer, but an effectual doer, this man will be blessed in what he does." So what is James saying? If we want to live an effective and a blessed life, we need to know the word, live by the word, and not forget the word. One more for you before we get into our main text. This is found in 2 Timothy, and this is the letter Paul wrote, one of the letters to Timothy, his protege, the young pastor who was about to pastor a church. And this is in chapter 3, verses 14 to 17. Again, very well-known scripture. "You, however," this is Paul speaking to Timothy, "you, however, continue in the things you have learned and become convinced of, knowing from whom you have learned them, and that from childhood you have known the sacred writings, which are able to give you the wisdom that leads to salvation through faith which is in Messiah Jesus. All scripture is inspired by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be adequate, equipped for every good work. So Paul's saying that if we're going to be trained the right way, we need to be trained in the word. And if we're going to disciple others, we need to disciple them in the word so they too can be like Timothy, be equipped for every good work. So for all of us who are believers and followers of Yeshua Jesus, we need to live our lives according to the truth of God's word. There's no other truth. There's no worldly truth. There's no societal truth. There's only one truth for us, and that's the truth of God's word. There's another aspect, and we're going to now get into our text of Luke 24 that I want to explore, and that is the word, knowing the word, enables us to believe in our hearts, not just know in our heads, but believe in our hearts about the one, Yeshua. So I'm going to ask you to please turn to Luke 24. The road to Emmaus starts with verse 13. We're not going to read the whole section. This is one of my favorite sections of Luke because I kind of chuckle at Yeshua. I think he's a little sly here when he pretends not to know what's going on. And, you know, he's going this way and the disciples say, "Come with us." "No, I'm kind of, I really can't. Come on, no." And then he goes. So we know the story of these two disciples. We only know the name of one of them, Cleopas, and they were down. They were downcast. They were sad. The one they hoped in, they saw on the cross. They heard reports, right, that the women ran to the tomb that they didn't see, but they couldn't accept it. They didn't believe it. So here we have in Luke 24, verse 25, right, Jesus, and they don't know at this time that it's Jesus, but he says something to them. When he hears what they're talking about, right, he says, "O foolish men and slow of heart to believe in all that the prophets have spoken. See, what Jesus is saying, that he believed that what was written in the Hebrew scriptures, okay, and remember the New Testament didn't exist at this point in time, but what was written in the Hebrew scriptures should have been sufficiently clear that these two disciples should have understood the meaning of what just took place. Now, if you look at the language he uses, he actually is chiding them. O foolish men, and slow of heart to believe in all the prophets have spoken. The implication here is that these two disciples should have recognized the events of the crucifixion and the reports of the resurrection as what, as fulfillments of Old Testament prophecy. But they did not. See, Jesus did not say, oh, my two friends, I feel so sorry for you, just couldn't understand what the prophets have spoken, because you didn't know their full sense of the meaning. No. He did not excuse them for their failure to understand. And I think we see why, because Jesus calls them what? Slow of heart to believe. I think Jesus is telling them that the problem of their was more in their heart that they didn't believe than rather their head. I'm going to have you turn out of Luke for a second, and we're going to look at John chapter 5. Look at verse 39 and jump down to 45 to 47 because we see something else. Now, this is Jesus not talking to disciples, but he's talking to the religious leaders. He's talking to the Pharisees. And we see the same problem. Jesus is very stern here. Verse 39, you search the scriptures because you think that in them you have eternal life. It is these that testify about me. In verse 45, do not think that I will accuse you before the Father. The one who accuses you is Moses, in whom you have set your hope. For if you believed Moses, you would believe me, for he wrote about me. But if you do not believe his writings, how will you believe my words? I think you'll see that the word believe is used often in these couple of verses. See, these religious leaders, they spent their entire lives pursuing and obtaining all the knowledge of the law, right? They knew it backwards, forwards, upside down, you name it, they knew it. But although they had the head knowledge, they failed to believe the truth of what their own scriptures were teaching. Not just what they were teaching, but who they were teaching about, which is Yeshua, the Messiah, who was promised in the Hebrew scriptures. It's amazing. They knew everything in their heads, but they failed to see and believe in the one that they were studying and hoping for, who was standing right in front of them. Why? Their hearts were not open. They did not believe. It's really sad that they missed their Messiah, the one who was that they studied for and searched for. I'll take you back to Luke, and we're going to call you to Luke 24:32, because we see something here as well. Again, these are the two disciples that Jesus encountered on the road to Emmaus. Now, this is after Jesus had stayed with them and revealed himself to them. They said to one another, were not our hearts burning within us while he was speaking to us on the road, while he was explaining the scriptures to us? See, these two disciples were about to do the same thing that the religious leaders did. They were about to miss the Messiah. But thanks to Yeshua, who explained the scriptures to them, they didn't miss the Messiah. That must have been one amazing Bible study that Jesus had with them on the road. I hope that when we are in the millennial kingdom together, we're all taking seminary classes, that Jesus is teaching Old Testament survey. I think it's going to be a great class. You know, there's no way, obviously no one knows any more about the Old Testament than Jesus himself. I'm going to chase a squirrel for a second here. I just got to say something. One of my favorite stories is when Jesus is, you know, Mary and Joseph realize he's not with them, right? and they go back, and where was he? He was in the temple, right? He was in the synagogue. My righteous imagination, Mary and Joseph go pick up Jesus, and so Yeshua, how was school? Mom, I got in trouble again with the yeshiva master. Why? He says I know too much and I keep raising my hand. So Miriam is her Hebrew name. Miriam drops Yeshua off on Monday, and the yeshiva master says to Miriam, "Your son, I don't know what to do with him. He keeps raising his hand. He hogs all the answers." So you guys remember the movie? What was that? The Disney movie about the family that had superpowers, Incredibles. Remember the end? The kid who raced all the time. It's all not to win every race. Come in second, right? So I can see Miriam see Yeshua. The other kids answer the questions. Don't raise your hand. Anyway, sorry, that took us on a rabbit hole. Because obviously, no one knows more about the Hebrew scriptures than the one who wrote the Hebrew scriptures, right? Jesus himself. So, okay, where was I? Here we are. So I actually think, if we go back to verse 32 for a second, here's what's so amazing about this verse. They say, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he was speaking?" When Jesus was giving them a Bible study, when he was speaking the truth of the Hebrew scriptures, the law, the writings and the prophets, they didn't know who it was, but it was the power and the ministry of God's word that burned in their hearts. And because of the truth of what they heard, their hearts were then filled with the belief necessary to see Yeshua as their Messiah. It was the very word of God that penetrated their hearts. So hopefully so far we see how it's the Hebrew scriptures not just teach us how to live, but they point us to who the Messiah is, Yeshua. So the last part of this devotional is our witness, how we should and need to know and use the Hebrew scriptures in our witness, especially to our Jewish friends and neighbors and family, and how the Hebrew scriptures point to Yeshua. And I'm going to have you turn, if you don't mind, to 1 Corinthians 15. The words will be on the screen if you can't turn there. Because before we get back into the text of Luke 24, the Apostle Paul, or a lot of people call him Rabbi Saul, says something very important here. And this is verse 3 in chapter 15. "For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Messiah died for our sins according to what? The scriptures, the Hebrew scriptures, we call it the Old Testament. And that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day, what? According to the scriptures." That means we should be able to take the Tanakh, the Old Testament, and help someone see the truth that the Old Testament in and of itself points to one, Yeshua, the Messiah. So let's go back to Luke, because what we're going to see is that Yeshua himself, he considered himself to be the fulfillment of Hebrew scriptures. He taught that all which was written in the law, prophets, and writings was messianic, and not only pointed to him, but was fulfilled by him. See, in his entire ministry, as you read through the New Testament, this is how he revealed himself. He revealed himself through what they already knew, which was the Hebrew scriptures. His understanding and questioning the Jewish people of the time about the Hebrew scriptures was an essential part of his ministry. And if we go back to Luke 24, we'll see this. So let's go back to Luke 24, but this time we're going to be in verse 26 and 27. Again, this is the teaching to the two on the Emmaus Road. This was before they realized it was him. This is what he says. "Was it not necessary for the Messiah to suffer these things and to enter into his glory? Then, beginning with Moses and with all the prophets, He explained to them the things concerning himself, where? In all the scriptures. It doesn't say he selected certain verses out of the Hebrew scriptures. It's in all the scriptures. All the Hebrew scriptures is entirely messianic and points to Yeshua. Now, if you go to the latter part of chapter 24, this is when he's appearing to his 11 disciples. And we're going to focus on verse 44. We see something very similar. Now he, this is Yeshua, said to them, "These are my words, which I spoke to you while I was still with you." That, here's that little word again, all, right? Sometimes the little words in the Bible are the biggest words, right? "That all things which are written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Again, Jesus believed that the whole of the Old Testament predicted the Messiah. It's evident in emphasis on the word all in both encounters. There's a really great, he's a wonderful man, Dr. Michael Rodelnik. He's professor of biblical studies at Moody Bible Institute. He's written a number of books. He's actually very involved with Chosen People Ministries. I'm trying to get through a 1,000-page book that he's edited right now about Messianic prophecy. And there's a quote that he has about this that's what I really like, so I wanted to share. And Dr. Michael Rodelnik states, "This emphasis on all shows that Jesus saw the Messiah not merely in occasional isolated texts, but in all the scriptures. Jesus' point was not that there is just one verse in each section of the Hebrew scriptures that point to the Messiah, but rather the whole of it." I love this last line. "Down to the DNA level, the entirety of the Old Testament was messianic." I think it's very powerful. So, Joel, that's really great information. Nice to know. What's the application? Well, the application, we're going to go back into Luke 24 to find the application. And I'll call your attention to verse 16. Here's the problem. "But their eyes were prevented from recognizing him." That's the problem we have today. When you encounter a Jewish person, their eyes or their hearts are blinded to the truth. They're not going to believe what you say right at first. They're not going to readily accept, unless God's been working on their heart, and praise God if that is the case. But the problem is, just like these two disciples on the road to Emmaus, their eyes are prevented from seeing and recognizing Jesus as their Messiah. Well, there's a solution. And let's go to verse 31. "Then their eyes were opened and they recognized him." Isn't that beautiful? That it's the word of God itself, spoken in truth, and obviously and in power, that when a hearer hears it, their eyes become open. And when their eyes become open, the eyes of the heart become open, they recognize the truth that Jesus is their Messiah. One more. We're going to stay in Luke 24 and look at 44 to 45. We already read 44, but we're going to add 45 to it. Again, these are to the 11 disciples. "Now he," Jesus, "said to them, 'These are my words, which I spoke to you while I was still with you, that all things which are written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled.' Then he," what? "Opened their minds to understand the scriptures." It is clear Luke is making a point, and that point is that spiritual insight was necessary to understand messianic prophecy, fulfilled completely in Yeshua, Jesus, as contained in the Hebrew scriptures. It was Jesus, and this two, with the disciples on the road to Emmaus and these disciples in the room, who opened their mind to understand the scriptures. Without divine enablement, they would not be able to see the truth of who Jesus is. It was true then, it's true today. We know that it's the power and the work of the Holy Spirit to open the eyes and the hearts of the unbelievers. It's not us who do that. That's not our role. What is our role? Our role is first and foremost to know God's word, and then to have the desire to take God's word to people. It's the Holy Spirit is the one who illuminates and leads a person to the truth. We are not responsible or are we capable of regenerating a human heart. We cannot do that. We need to partner with the Holy Spirit. And there's three ways we can partner with the Holy Spirit. And I mentioned the first one. We need to know God's word. I can't make it any clearer. I love God's word, and I feel like every time I open God's word, I realize how much I don't know of God's word. I just want to know more. But I really want to understand the Hebrew scriptures. So I can be in front or be with a Jewish person and say, let's look at your own scriptures. Let's look at the Hebrew scriptures, right? The Old Testament, and see how the New Testament fulfills everything in the Old Testament. Second, I mentioned this too, we need to have a desire in our hearts. Look, we all have Jewish friends, co-workers, family. There's a Jewish community out there, which our heart is to impact the Jewish community. Sometimes it's just a simple invitation. Sometimes it's just, hey, are you open to at least looking at your own Old Testament, your own Hebrew scriptures? Sit down with them and say, what do you think this means? Who do you think this is pointing to? You know, how do you answer this question? Because we know that the entirety of the Old Testament is messianic. Third and probably the most important thing, what we can do is pray. Pray. Pray that God gives you just the right words, that when you're in a situation to share the truth of Yeshua with a Jewish person, God speaks to you. You don't have to hit him over the head with the NASB, largest print possible, because I can't see Bible, right? No, you just have to speak truth. Yes, you got to get questions, and you need to know where to go in the Hebrew scriptures, but pray. Without prayer, nothing is possible. Pray for the Jewish community. Pray for the Jewish community here in Orlando. Please, pray for this fellowship. Our desire is to see this room eventually full of Jewish people who are searching for the truth of Jesus, because they need to know about the one who came and died for them and rose again to fulfill every single prophecy. Now, wouldn't it be wonderful, I'll close with this, that if you were actually engaging with a Jewish person, that as you sit down with them, they would respond to you the same way Philip responded in John 1:45 when he saw Jesus. And the words will be up on the screen, right? This would be amazing. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, we have found him of whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. Philip knew the word of God. And when he saw Jesus, he knew that everything he studied and everything he knew was fulfilled in the personhood of Yeshua Jesus who encountered him. I pray that is what happens for all of us. But we just have to be willing to go, and we have to know the scriptures, and we have to pray that God will lead the people that we talk to, the people that we encounter, that they would have an encounter in the truth of God's word. Let's just close in prayer before Daniel and Jeremy come back up. Father God, we just thank you for your word of truth. Lord, I thank you that your word is actually really clear. Lord, that your word points to your son Jesus. That it was always him, and it is him today who takes away the sins of the world. Father God, I would pray for every person here in this room that you would help us understand your word even more than we ever did before. And Lord, when we are gathered together at a fellowship or on our own, study your word, Lord, that our hearts would burn, that when we hear your word, our minds would be sharp. Lord, that when we go out into our jobs and in our communities, and even for some of us, our own families, Lord, Lord, you give us the words to speak. Lord, you help us to know where to go in your word, that we can just share the truth of who you are, Yeshua. Lord, we know that you have people out there, especially the Jewish community, Lord, who need to know who you are, that need to turn their hearts and their lives over to you. Lord, I pray that you introduce us to those people, that when we encounter them, Lord, you work through us. All glory goes to you, Heavenly Father. It is your name that gets praised, your name that gets honored, and we just want to do your work. And I pray this in the name of Jesus, our Messiah. Amen.
It's an awesome portion of scripture. Probably should just leave it where Joel left it, but I love the response. Philip knew the scriptures, but I love Nathaniel's response. Says, can anything good come out of Nazareth? But his response is the perfect one. He says, come and see. He takes him to Jesus, you know? So get that little bit of resistance and just show him Jesus. And Jesus didn't respond in any horrible way. He looked at him and he's like, he complimented him. He's like, you, an Israelite in whom there is no deceit, you know? So it was an awesome word. Thanks, Joel.
You know sin, and be my
If you don't know, Kiddush is Hebrew for holiness. And these blessings are said before Shabbat starts, and when Shabbat is a different blessing when Shabbat ends, but also for holidays. I'll just share with you that I honestly got convicted last week. It does not matter if you're Jewish or not. We are called to enter into God's rest. And when we usher in Shabbat with the blessings, what we're doing is we're setting this day apart. The text that is typically read is Genesis 2:1-3, when God rested from creation. So I encourage you all, because we're all believers in Jesus here, to maybe consider tonight or tomorrow, rest in the Lord. Whether you rest from your activities, rest from your work, that's up to you. But I'm encouraging myself, and I encourage each one of you to find that space to just rest in the Lord, because He is good and His work is finished. So again, we look to the words of Yeshua found in John 6:35. Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. He who comes to me will not hunger, and he who believes in me will never thirst." So we take a piece of the bread, and if you know this, please recite it with me. Baruch Ata Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam Ha'amati Lechem Min Haaretz. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who brings forth bread from the earth. Again, we look to the words of Yeshua, found in the Gospel of John 7:37. Now on the last day, the great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried out, saying, "If anyone is thirsty, let him come to me and drink." And if you know this prayer, please say it out loud with me. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam Barei Pri Hagafen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who creates the fruit of the vine. And with that, Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom.
I encourage you to stay around and just fellowship with some snacks. Before I forget, next month on the first Friday of March, I think it's March 1st maybe, I'm not sure. 4th, thank you. We're going to have a Purim party. It's going to be a lot of fun. It's the story of Esther. Bring your kids. We're going to have a lot of kids' activities. If you've never eaten hamantaschen before, it's a great pastry that is special for Purim. It's a great opportunity to invite your Jewish friends and neighbors. And please mark your calendars. I think I can officially say this. I just got to get final confirmation. But we believe we're going to have a Passover Seder here at the church on April 8th. I just really think Pastor Will. But we are still going to have our April fellowship, which is the Friday before April 1st. So we might have a little mini Passover get together. I haven't decided yet, but two great opportunities, really, to invite your friends. Great opportunity if you know some Jewish people who you've been wanting to, you know, get them exposed to the truth about who Yeshua is. Passover is a wonderful time to do so. So with that, thank you. Hang around and talk and fellowship, and Shabbat Shalom.